Welcome everybody. My name is Marlon de Boer. I'm working as a system engineer for the social networking site Hyves. I was wondering before I start how many people really know the website Hyves. Okay, quite a lot. That's a good thing. Okay, first I want to explain what Hyves actually is from a technical point of view. So Hyves is a social network, much like MySpace or Facebook. Currently, we use three data centers all around Amsterdam, all connected to the MSX Internet Exchange. Our department consists of 12 full-timers at the moment. It's just for the system engineers. So we have other departments as well that do the front-end programming. Currently, we're doing about 25 terabytes daily external traffic. So not just the external. Internally, we do a lot more. We have about 200 million page views daily. That's quite a lot. And at peak moments, we do about 80 million page views. To be able to serve that much page views, we have about 2,500 servers at the moment, which all need managing. And with 12 people, that is a problem if you don't have a thing like Puppet installed. So what is Puppet? Puppet actually is a system configuration framework. You can describe parts, or you describe what you would like to do in manifest, in Puppet manifest. Actually, you could say, I want to have Apache started, or I want to manage my etc password file, or my host file. It's entirely written in Ruby. So yeah, for some people that could be a problem, but yeah, you have to install Ruby to be able to use Puppet. It's created by Luke Keynes. He was entirely fed up with CF Engine and all the other tools because they lacked the ability to use the abstraction layer, because you have to write everything for the specific environment you're in. You can't use it on BSD as well on Linux easily. With Puppet, that's much more easily to do because it detects on which Unix system you are, and you can almost use the same code. Much of the deeper info is available at Reductive Labs. I don't have the time to go into depth, so just want to show you how Puppet works. It's a client-server model. So you have a central server where all your Puppet code lives, which you write, and all the clients connect to it, and the server compiles your manifest, makes sure it's unique for your host, and then the client receives it, executes it, and makes sure it gets run properly. To ensure you're speaking to the right server, some people are concerned about security, or perhaps even want to run Puppet over the public internet. It's using SSL certificates, so that way you can make sure that you're connecting to the right host. This is an example of the CIPP file. This is actually where in Puppet you declare all your hosts, which you want to manage. In this example, I've called the host some node. Normally, this will reflect your DNS host name. You're allowed to use any kind of variables inside your node declaration. So in this example, I've used the operating system Solaris, and I want to manage SSH on this specific host, so I'm importing the Puppet manifest for SSH. In the actual SSH manifest, you can see we're managing the SSHD config file, and here you can see the benefit from being more abstract. You can actually check on which operating system you are. So for Solaris, you can have a different path as you have for the default environment, which could be your Linux or BSD machine. In this example, I want the file to always be owned by root, the group root. I should have the mode 644. Actually, when a user changes this on the system and Puppet runs again, you can set intervals at which time Puppet runs, it will correct your changes. So if somebody changed the file to nobody, first time Puppet will run, it will change back to root. So it's also a tool to detect errors users made. The last part is the servers. You actually, in this example, you're subscribing the file from above to the service SSHD. So if anything changes in the SSHD file, Puppet will actually restart your SSHD daemon with the new settings, so you don't have to do it manually. Okay, some of the Puppet features, there are more, but for our environment, these are the most important ones. Puppet is able to run on every Unix architecture that can compile Puppet, or Ruby. So in theory, you could even run Puppet on your jailbreaked iPhone. What really is handy in our environment is that we can use templates. This reduces the amount of files we have to control. So for example, if you have different locations and you want to have different firewalls or different resolve entries, you can just put in the variables like you saw in this IPP, and the template can find out on which location you are. And yeah, with Ruby, you can even put in for loops or other things to automatically generate the content of that file without having to have 20 files in a specific directory and include the right one. Other thing Puppet has is the factor library. Factor is a library that shows you, for example, the amount of cores a machine has, how much free memory, how much interfaces it has, and can show you which IP addresses are on that interfaces. There are much more features, but mainly we use those to spawn the right amount of Apache instances or generate our firewall for specific IP addresses. Puppet also supports types and functions. If I go back one sheet, a type is, in this example, will be the file type and the service type. There are a lot of more. You can use the contact type, for example, or the exec type. The contact manages your contact entries on every Unix host that supports it. And functions, for example, we use a couple of custom functions we wrote our own. We can ask on any given time which versions of software is running, or IP addresses we can bind on specific interfaces, and we wrote custom functions for that. The only problem with the functions are that they only get executed on the compile host, so that's the main server. If you want to use it on clients, you have to do something with types, because the types are executed on the client side. Other feature we use from Puppet is the database backend support. All the facts that are available can be written into a database backend. We use MySQL for that, and that way we can run out support, all kinds of statistics. We can see which servers are on which version of the kernel, or use how many cores, how much memory is in it. So it's very quick to just get an overview if you have a large server park. Other thing Puppet supports is the external node definitions. If I go back to the site PP, if you have a really large number of hosts and you already have another system for your asset management from your service, you can write your own script to generate some of this content without having to take the rest of the server part. Going the wrong way, sorry. Okay, now I'll go to the point why we use Puppet at Hyves. We started out with the SSH for loop, as most of the system engineers do. We found out that doesn't scale, so we tried to figure out something for that, and we came across Puppet. Mainly what we do, if we install servers, we rip open the box, press on F12 to do a PXC install, and it boots our quick start the first time, sets the host name, and in Puppet we put in the right node definition, and Puppet will do the rest. So that way we can be operational within 7 minutes, for example, for our main web servers, our front-end servers. If we rip open the box, put it into a rack, push the F12 button, and we're up and running within 7 minutes. So I think that, yeah, it's pretty good time to get your server operational. What do we actually manage with Puppet in our environment? Like I said before, some of the DNS entries or the resolve and the NTP servers, firewalls, are all location aware. If we had to do that by hand, it would be a hell of a job to keep up. We use Gentoo on our servers. And we don't want to compile all the packages on their own host, so we have a centralized package system, and Puppet can fetch packages from there and install or update if needed. Puppet also starts to require services. So for example, if we have the main web class, to make sure that Apache is started, the SSH is started, and the monitoring services. Other group we use a lot is the database backend. And of course, that would start MySQL. Other thing we use it for is to push updates. That can be packages or config files. If we do have to roll out security update, we can use Puppet for that. And Puppet will restart all our services to update the config. Other problem we came across when we used Puppet is that it doesn't scale well behind over about 800 servers in the webbrick configuration, which I think most people still use. Problem with the webbrick is that's single-threaded, so even if you have more cores in your machine, you can't use them. So what we did, we used the Mongrel Ruby implementation for HTTP and split off the SSL part to a SSL-capable proxy. In our environment, we use Nginx, but you can use Pound or Apache as well. This way, you can load balance some spawned instances of your Mongrel, and that way you can use multiple cores on one machine. If you get to the point that doesn't scale on one machine anymore, you can build your own trusted SSL chain. So Puppet clients can connect to multiple servers instead of one. Other thing we do, we have passive clients. Normally, the Puppet clients run in a defined interval and just connect to the server. But if you have a lot of servers, you will create your own natural DOS attack in your own network. So what we did, we push all the clients are passive, and we push all the updates serialized throughout our Puppet master to keep the load low. How we do that? You have a program that's called Puppet Run. You can just, we have a script around that just in batches of 10 servers calls the Puppet Run. The Puppet runner on the master will connect to the client and say, you can run now, so then it will connect to your server. That way, yeah, you can easily reduce the load and don't have to think about the interval the Puppet clients will start. Okay, if there are any questions, you can ask them now.
You use the database backend. I tend to use it as well for like Nagios.
Mm-hmm.
To configure other to fill that form puppet with some CGI scripts. Do you use it for that kind of purpose as well?
Okay, the question was if we used the DB backend to feed them to Nagios or any monitoring tool. No, we have our own other database, which we actually started with for assets management, and we use that database to create our Nagios configs. But we're planning to merge them or do something else with it.
Well, I'm at the designing stage, so I can choose to have one database.
Right? Okay. Sorry, time's up. If you want to meet me, please come outside.